with JSP. Okay. Not very active. Okay. Good. Okay. Okay. Previously active. Okay. So my name is Manikandan. So I'm one of the core member of Madras Java ISO group. And it has been a really exciting path for last more than a couple of years. And even beyond that, we have been associated. So it has been a good knowledge sharing sessions. I would request you to join our monthly meetings, because that's where most of our informal talks get shaped into a lot of action. So it can be most of things happen within our corporate lives. So we have a medium to exchange those ideas. So I think I have troubled a lot, like posing a lot of questions to Anki. A lot of thought process has gone into our projects with respect to inputs from various members of the jungle. So it's, I will not say it's going to be, you know, like one or two. So the entire, as a community, we are actually exchanging a lot of information. DevOps was one of our major discussions. So we are gearing up to do a case study completely on one project, seeing like where we are able to implement that to a greater extent. So I would invite you for our monthly meetings so that you can be an active part, as well as you can contribute more towards the technology, your organization, as well as few things which your organization may not give you scope to work on. So those things we can start working on. Santosh and myself have already identified one community project for us. So we felt the necessity sometime back, but today I think after the JUG meeting, we'll put forth that proposal to Tamil and other community members. Okay. So I made this little talk so that I get warmed up, as well as you get warmed up. Okay, so JSP, expression language. So we all know that how the JSP came into play. People got bored with writing the Java code, and also there are a lot of errors. Okay, and the compilation process and other things. It was little verbose, not readable, not maintainable. So much more easier for people to write in. So this JSP designers, so who might not know a lot of Java code, so they have to start coding, the page authoring, what we call as. So they have to do a lot. And expression language plays one of a significant role in simplifying that process to write a JSP code. So I have to give credits to my colleagues. One, Mr. R. Srinivasan, is the director of the organization, and also one of my team members, Narma. They have put in a lot of efforts and work in towards writing custom EL resolvers. So where in one of our projects, our business users had a lot of their own grammars. So they have brought in a lot of grammars for the content authoring, and we have done quite a bit of research onto it, finding the best way to write it. So I think if I get a slot in one of the monthly meetings, we can discuss in much more greater detail. But here I will just touch the surface. Okay. So I will not just go through into each of these lines, but the expression language, this is how it looks like. So you can just put a dollar and a curly brace, and you just put in a variable. So this, the beauty of the expression language is it can be an expression like 2 plus 2, or it can be like a normal expression that can be evaluated at the if level, or it can be like a order dot value, where this order can be in a request scope, or in a session scope, or even in an application scope. So generally, when we need to write it, generally we say request dot get parameter, then session dot get attribute, servlet context get attribute. So all those things need not be okay. Those things goes behind the scenes. So it is getting resolved. The expression language is getting evaluated, and it is going to be. So this order dot get value can be like your Java code can be something like request dot get attribute of this order and then order.getValue. So this is much verbose, easier to read, and it is easier for the JSP page authors to write it, and it is easily readable also. So this is an API for deferred evaluation of expressions that refers to either values or methods on an object, something like get value, or it can refer directly to a variable also. So it was introduced in JSP version 2.0, but if you look at it, JSP 2.1, 2.2 has come up, and with JEE 7 specification, that's the recent one that has come up. So you can see a lot of improvements in terms of JSP EL. Okay. A normal expression would look like this. So anything that you define within a dollar and a curly brace becomes an expression. So it can be relational, logical, arithmetic, conditional, empty operators. And with JEE 7, you can also have functions implemented as static methods and Java classes. You can invoke them as well. You can also write custom tags, which can be also called up. Okay. As I told you, it's much easier because there is little or no Java coders on that page, because surely there is some amount of Java code that goes behind the scenes, but from a page authoring perspective, there is little or no Java code. Expressions make authoring very much easier. Okay, you can also like have an expression like GT. People need not always say in a greater than that angular brace. They can always say GT, EQ. So those kinds of easier way to write it. Readability is very high. It is highly verbose. So which means maintenance also much easier. Okay, I'll directly, okay, take you to one of the JSP examples. Okay. 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 So. Readable? Okay. Just have given a string title. User agent example. Okay, this is how you write as a scriptlet, out.println, and then, okay, this is, you can see here, this is an expression. Okay, so there are some objects which will be evaluated implicitly, like the header, parameters, session, scoped variables, page scoped variables, title is a page scoped variable. Okay, so what happens is here, generally when you want to get a header, you will say request dot get header of those things, and then you need to write this. So this is an easiest example. Okay, just put a dollar header of user agent. This is going to be either this array notation, either it can be an array or a map. So this can dig into a array or a map, and it can bring that value. Okay, this is the example that I am going to run. So I have just hosted a local Tomcat. I'll just adding a parameter on the top. Okay. So you can here you can see the user agent, that is the browser information coming up. And here you can, okay, it's not so visible, but it's Anki Reddy on the, okay, he's going to take our next session. So in his honor, I just put his name. Okay. So this is a much easier way of looking at things. And it's, again, a cookie can be referred. Cookie, you know, it comes as an array. Then you have to get the array. Either if you want to access it like a map, then you need to push into a map and then get it. So a lot of wrapper code we have to write it. Boilerplate code we have to write, but since this expression is making things much more easier, you can directly write like this. Okay, I think this is a slideshow in progress. Okay. Okay, implicit resolution, what it can resolve, page scope objects, request scope, session scope, application scope, param. Param is what we saw in the earlier slide in this example. Param of my name. And you can see the header also. Param value, param, param values, header, header values, initialization parameters, cookie, page context. So you don't need to put any extra effort to retrieve or process these values. Okay, and how this is being done? Anything that needs to be resolved, you have to have a resolver in the background working for you. Okay, there's no magic. Okay, there is no silver bullet. Somebody has to do the code. When we say the boilerplate code is getting dropped or we are cutting those things, which means someone has to substitute that effort. So these are the two EL resolvers. Who is actually doing it? Implicit object EL resolver, scoped attribute EL resolver. What happens is when it sees this expression, okay, you are when dynamically when it is getting processed, the page is getting processed, this expression is going to pass down to a set of resolvers, okay, a array of resolvers or a chain of resolvers. So what happens? That expression, for example, it will go to the implicit object EL resolver first. So it is trying to find whether it is a page scope component. Okay, leave out the scope. Okay, it's a parameter value, it's a header value, or it's a cookie, or a init param, or a page context. It is not able to resolve. So it will pass on that information to the scoped resolve EL resolver. It will call the next, the logic will call the next EL resolver in the chain or in the logic. That will be the scoped attribute EL resolver. This will try to resolve whether it is in the session, whether it is in the request, or it is in the application. Even if it is not able to find it, then it will, the next, it's like more of a chain of responsibility pattern. Okay, we will write it, and these things are wired together in a composite EL resolver. So there will be a composite EL resolver to which all these EL resolvers get registered to. So in the order in which we specify, it is going to get resolved. Yeah. Yes. No, you don't need to use both. What happens is the containers give a implementation of them. So javax.tl is more of an interface where the containers like Tomcat or JBoss, they give WebLogic, WebSphere provides an implementation for them. So out of the box, you have these resolvers. So it is given, it is guaranteed that these things will be implemented. So you don't have to extract it? No, you don't need to do anything. For implicit behavior, you don't need to do anything at all. Yes. Like how you have a local and an instance, always a local is given much more preference. So in this scenario, a request will be getting a precedence. Okay, the core concept is EL is the evaluation of a model object, name into an object, the resolution of the properties or methods applied to in an expression. Say in the earlier example, we saw that order dot value. So first the order, the base object needs to get resolved, and then the operators or the array or the further attributes or the methods is going to get resolved. Okay, these are some of the standard EL resolvers that you already have. Array EL resolver, so this is how you will write it. So this expression will be resolved by this array EL resolver. Employee.lname, you have a bean EL resolver, which means this is going to be identified. You can imagine that in the composite EL resolver or somewhere, it's going to be like, okay, if this is an instance of array, then you call this resolver. If this is an object or a bean, you call this resolver. If it's going to be a list, then call this resolver. If it's a map, then call this resolver. this is how it's going to be done. So it's, yeah. Yes. Yes. It's given in the container level itself. It's the container level. See how you how the service method is invoked directly by the container. Similarly, the JSP when it's compiling. Yes. So I said there is no magic bullet or a silver bullet. There is nothing going to be coming as a magic. So there should be some logic in behind the scenes running which has to make this happen. That is going to be the EL resolver. So for each kind of expression you want to evaluate, there is going to be some kind of a resolver in the back end, okay, running behind the scenes, which is going to do that. Okay, so when you say employee.lastName, a bean EL resolver, okay, the chain of resolver is going to test whether who will be able to evaluate this expression. So first, a bean EL resolver will say that I will be able to resolve this, so leave it to me, do not invoke any further resolvers. So then it will start then looking into this pattern again, then it will invoke the get last name and then it will do the resolution. So all EL resolvers are combined together using composite EL resolver. Okay. So in which scenarios we will need a custom EL resolver? So this is one of the case. Imagine you have a content management system. Okay, imagine you have a content management system. Your business user wants to create a kind of a blog. So you have a data model which says, okay, a blog is nothing but an article. Okay, and for that article, he wants to display some images. Okay, so in the content management system, you upload the images, you get a reference ID. Okay, you ask the business users to go and hard code that ID into the HTML of the article. Okay, 50% chances they are going to copy paste the ID or type the ID, it is going to go somewhere wrong. So what the ideal usage will be like, okay, there is already images there associate to the article, like related images. Okay, associate via the GUI, select, filter, and then associate that article. So the article will have a property called, like it can be a collection of images. So where it is going to just refer to it, so there is no need to, okay, hard code some information. But how will they refer that information inside that article, HTML? So instead of hard coding IMG, SRC, doing all those things, they can just say, okay, $RelatedMedia.1. So what happens here is, when the idea is we should write a EL resolver, okay, which will actually take this related media, okay, it will register against the composite EL resolver saying that I will resolve this related media. So whenever the keyword, okay, expression related media comes up, okay, you give the control to me, I will be able to handle this. And then it has an understanding of the article data model. So we have to write the logic. So dot one is going to be nothing but in the list of images given, fetch the first one. Then expand that to maybe a CDN URL. It may be a CDN distributed URL, or it may be translating to a physical path on the same server. So that logic can also be encapsulated somewhere else. You just make a call, then expand this related media.1 into a URL which is much more easier for business to handle, and also we have a appropriate technology to handle this. So this we have built for one of our clients. So we came up with this kind of a similar kind of an expression. Okay, so the same, whatever the so article has a related images, that's a collection. And then the business user in the CMS authoring area associates the media, which is already in the CMS, to the article and uses the expression related media dot one, related media dot two to embed the images in the article. So again, a resolver is tied to grammar. What is the grammar here? The grammar is much more easier. The related media is the grammar with which we define our expression. So for implicit objects to get resolved, we don't need to put in any additional effort. It's going to be as simple as you just need to consume it. You don't need to worry about how it is getting evaluated. But here, when you are coming with your own expression, which means you should provide the context, you should provide the logic, you should provide the code to process those expressions. So that is where we are coming at. So we will educate the business users or whoever is doing, okay, to use that grammar. So the related media is the grammar that ties the resolver to these types of expression, and the resolver will have the logic to figure out what one means, because we are defining the grammar here. It can be .one or .two, but it doesn't have a context, it doesn't have a meaning at the container level or out of the box or from the existing APIs. So we need to say that how this one should be interpreted, how it should be done. Again, we need to look at the other scenarios also. .0, if someone gives, what to do? Or someone is giving 24. Are we going to throw array index out of bounds exception? Or how we can say no image is there, just replace some kind of a. So how to handle those kinds of an alternate flows also, rainy day scenarios also, you should come up with that, and you have to do that. So how we will do it? Write a custom EL resolver, add it to composite EL resolvers. Okay, then in the JSP, okay, there are two types of authoring what we are talking about. The earlier authoring what we were talking about is the JSP authoring. There is a page authoring where at the development time people know what they are actually trying to evaluate. But here we are trying to evaluate a content. So while at the right of when we write the code, when we author the page, we have no idea what is that going to contain. So what we will do is, we'll just not say article.body, we'll say article.body.eval, and this eval will trigger the processing. So we will write code. First we'll write a EL resolver and we'll tie it to composite EL resolver, and apart from that we'll say that whenever you find this .eval, okay, treat that content, explicitly trigger the evaluation of expression. So because what happens without this EL eval, what happens is the expression inside the content will not get evaluated, it will just get printed. So we need to say that there is also expressions within the content, you also evaluate that. So it unless
the EL, if the article is a bean, then the bean EL eval resolver will,
yes, it will fire and it will print, it will give the content. But what happens, even for this eval we have to tie it up. What are the resolvers, all those things. But again, we need to say that this is more like should be treated as a, this can be evaluate EL or resolve EL, it can be anything of, it's of our choice. Okay, or we can say that software AGEL or VAMsoft EL, we can give any name that we want. But this will be tied the code. So there is not, there is no just a linear flow. This is this happens like how message bean or something is getting, you prepare something, okay, it's going to be, a code is going to get fired up, it's going to be added in the context listener, then it gets added to the composite EL resolver and it gets waiting for something to come in. But for something to come in, this is the trigger point. So this happens. So expressions inside the content are found and evaluated. So the eval here triggers the resolution mechanism of the EL. Okay. So we found a very good slide share from Reza Rahman with respect to what's new with expression language in GWE7 also. So I have included other set of resolvers. So I'll just show you. One EL resolver. This I will take it. I'll just show you some examples of So they will create a new composite EL resolver. I think I'll just add it. So this space has a lot of reference to the open source things. You write composite EL resolver equal to new composite EL resolver, result.add skin properties EL resolver, new resource EL resolver. So this URL has a lot of references to all open source projects.
Okay, if I write custom EL resolver,
yeah.
Registered in WebDataX
and no, what generally you will do is it has to run before the web application context is initialized. So generally you will write it in a context initialized. And then you will call that. So you will write a separate EL configuration class, so which will have all this information. That you create a object, or you just call a static method from there. Depends on the architecture, but from the context initialized, you have to call this so that it gets these things get ready before all the page processing and those things are ready.
There is no direct points from WebDataX.
No. So it should be in the startup code, so you directly put it in the context initialized. So this is with respect to which project? Okay, dphase, I think should be some Java faces kind of a project. So here they have written new composite EL resolver. Faces implement implicit object EL resolver, because faces also it adds a lot of at a framework level it is also handling a lot of objects of its own kind, so it needs to resolve that too. Faces variable resolver, chain wrapper, faces property resolver, chain, then you can see that resource bundle, faces map, list, array, bean. So it will be added in this order. So unless you have a requirement to define or write your own custom EL resolver, you will not touch these areas. So we tried to eliminate that part also, because in the one of our earlier projects, we had a lot of email content as a template. We wrote it as a markdown template, and then we got it inside. And wherever there's, for example, like a mail merge kind of a facility you want, we used Apache, some library to just take those expressions and substitute it with objects, the values and objects and some of the things. But those were restricted to a limited kind of a thing. So we know that we are sending an email to the customer on registration. We know that the customer object is going to be the only object that is going to be involved. So there's more of a well-defined boundaries of which objects is going to play a part in that content. But when you are talking about like a content management system, you can actually look into various other things that is getting defined, which is getting associated. So it can be, some of them can be internal, some of them can be external, some of them can be even like a solving a mathematical expression and getting those things evaluated. So after a lot of thought process and brainstorming, we found that, okay, this is the only way to do it, or else it's going to be pretty tough for us.
I saw a date format example, some customized date
format. Okay.
They were using some customized date format.
Okay. Okay.
Different paths
Okay.
Date formats should be printed.
Okay.
So if you are using that code within your JSP, it will look somewhat.
Yes, yes, it will be very shabby actually. And most of them, it's get actually like it will be used in multiple pages also. So it's better to keep the logic in one end and do the process. Okay. I think we will pass on the stage to Anki so that he can start using that. Okay. Thank you.